In this video, we're going to talk about rotation matrices and the properties of these matrices. So let's suppose that we've got a rotation. It doesn't have to be in two dimensions or three dimensions. It can be in 17 dimensions. We've got a rotation, and we can think of it as an n by n matrix, or you can think of it as just an operation that takes vectors and turns them around. Now, the first thing you notice about rotations is that they preserve length. You can turn something around, turn it upside down, twist it however you like, and it stays the same length. It also preserves the angle between any two vectors, and therefore it preserves the inner product, because the inner product is the length of one times the length of the other times the cosine of the angle between them. The remaining properties are a bit more subtle. They have to do with the matrix itself. If you look at the columns of the matrix, I claim that all of the columns are orthonormal, and that the transpose of the matrix times the matrix is the identity. In other words, the transpose is the inverse of the matrix. And likewise, R times its transpose is the identity. And finally, that the columns of the transpose, which you might think of as the rows of R, except that to me, vectors are always columns, are also orthonormal. And what's more is that any matrix that has one of these properties automatically has all of the other properties as well. So let's see why that works. So first we're going to show that if you preserve length, you preserve angle, and you preserve the inner product. To see that, we use what's called a polarization identity. You can get the inner product between two vectors from a length, because it's the length of their sum squared minus the length of their difference squared, all divided by 4. If you expand this out, this is going to be length of x squared plus length of y squared plus twice, sorry, length of rx squared plus length of ry squared plus twice the dot product. And then you subtract this squared plus this squared minus twice the dot product. You get 4 times the dot product. Divide by 4, you get the inner product. So if r preserves lengths, then the length of x plus y is the length, sorry, the length of rx plus y is the length of x plus y. And then you get the same calculation, and you get that the inner product of rx with ry is the inner product of x with y. The same identity that related inner products to lengths for rx and ry relates inner products and length for x and y. Okay. Likewise, if something preserves inner products, then the length of rx squared is the inner product of rx with itself, which the inner product of x with itself is the length of x squared. So of our properties, rotations preserve length, rotations preserve angles, and inner products. If it preserves the inner product, it preserves the length, and vice versa. Now we want to show the columns are orthonormal. To do that, we just say, hey, what's the inner product of the ith column with the jth column? Well, the ith column of a matrix is what you get when you apply that matrix to EI, the vector that has a 1 in the ith slot and a 0 everywhere else. And likewise, the jth column is what you apply R to EJ. But if you preserve the inner product, then this is the inner product of EI with EJ, and that's 1 if I equals J and 0 if they're not equal. So 2 implies 3. Next, we're going to show that R transpose R is the identity. The ij entry of R transpose R is the ith row of R transpose times the jth column of R. And that's exactly the inner product of REI and REJ, because this is the ith column of R transpose. And we just said that REI and REJ are orthonormal. And so this gives you 1 if I equals J, and 0 if I is not equal to J. Next, we're going to show that if R transpose R is the identity, then you preserve inner products. So we're going to go from 4 back up to 2. To do that, we note that the inner product of RX and RY Applying an R to Y is the same thing as applying an R dagger to Rx, but the dagger of a real matrix is its transpose. So that's R transpose Rx inner product with Y, and we just said that R transpose R was the identity, so this is X inner product with Y. So let's see what we've got right now. We've got 1 and 2 are the same. 2 implies 3, 3 implies 4, 4 implies 2. So 1, 2, 3, and 4 are all the same. Now 4 and 5 are pretty easily seen to be the same because both of these say that R transpose is R inverse. And then the way we go back and forth between 5 and 6 is really the same as the way you go back and forth between 3 and 4. Just you swap the roles of R transpose, of R and R transpose. So we've shown that any one property implies the other five. And so we've got a definition. The definition is we will call a real matrix orthogonal if it has one of those properties and therefore all of these properties. Now, orthogonal if the transpose is the inverse. Now you might think that since the columns are orthonormal, we really ought to call it an orthonormal matrix. And maybe we should, but we don't. The analogous thing for complex matrices is unitary. And here we don't want the transpose, we want the transpose conjugate, or the dagger. So a complex matrix is unitary if U dagger is U inverse. And so a unitary matrix that happens to be real is the same thing as an orthogonal matrix. And finally, if you have don't have matrices, but just have an operator on an inner product space, we call the operator unitary if its adjoint equals its inverse. Okay. Now, a side comment on determinants of orthogonal matrices. If R transpose R is the identity, then the determinant of R transpose R is 1. But that's the determinant of R transpose that times the determinant of R, which is the determinant of R squared. So that means that if you have an orthogonal matrix, the determinant of R must be either 1 or minus 1. The ones, if the determinant is plus 1, then what you have is a rotation. If it's minus 1, then there's a reflection built in. The way to see that is you can always rotate to get the first column of R to be pointing in the one direction. And then you can rotate to get the second column to be in the 2 direction, and rotate to get the third column to be in the E3 direction, and so on. And after you've put all the columns but the last one in place, the last one has to be orthogonal to the rest, so it's either pointing in the EN direction or the minus EN direction. If it's a rotation, it's pointing in the EN direction, and the determinant is 1. If the determinant is minus 1, you had a reflection built in. Okay. Last thing is, should talk about what are the properties of unitary matrices as opposed to orthogonal matrices. So unitaries are just like orthogonals, only on complex vector spaces. They preserve length, they preserve inner product. If it's a matrix, the columns are orthonormal. In other words, that means that the adjoint is the inverse, and the columns of the adjoint are orthonormal, which is to say the rows of the original matrix are orthonormal. Any matrix that has one of these properties has all of these properties, and we call it unitary.